From Ingalls Rink in New Haven, Connecticut, this is ECAC Hockey on Nesson. Tonight, the Yale Bulldogs and head coach Keith Allain host former assistant Red Gendron and the Maine Black Bears. Thanks for joining us here at Yale alongside Rob Ciambra. I'm Kevin Gale. In 2013, Keith Allain and Red Gendron combined to win the Bulldogs' first hockey national title. The next season, Gendron went north to take care of the Black Bears. Tonight, they face off as rivals for just the second time. So how can Yale best a former assistant?
Well, it's all about discipline, staying out of the penalty box. The Black Bears are very good on the special teams. Plus, the Bulldogs are coming off a weekend sweep. Got to ride that momentum. It's only been a couple days since.
Yale's Keith Allain says his defense is much improved since the season opener back on November 1st, and sophomore defenseman Jack St. Ivany is a big reason why. What does this Flyers draft pick do to stand out in the ECAC?
Well, that 6'3 frame for starters, but he's a great mover of the puck as well. 6 assists on the season. He added one this weekend, Kevin.
Maine's offense ranks 9th out of 11 in Hockey East. However, senior forward Mitch Fassier ranks 11th best in the NCAA with 20 points. What makes him so dangerous at left wing?
Well, 17 of those 20 points are assists. He dishes the puck so well. He is always a threat on the ice. You gotta watch out because he could shoot it, but he's gonna look to dish it.
Maine has an opportunity to make it 7 wins in the last 10 meetings with Yale. The Black Bears out of Hockey East, 8-7-3 overall. The Yale Bulldogs, 4-7-0, as you mentioned, Rob. They're trying to pick up a third win in the last 5 days. Yale in the home whites, Maine in the road blues, and we are underway here on Nesson. Great to have you on board. Club down into the corner. Billy Sweezy wearing the assistant captain's A tonight. There is a big missing piece of this puzzle. The lone captain wearing the C, senior Evan Smith at forward, is not available tonight due to injury.
4 points on the season, plus the heart and soul of this lineup. Going to be tough for the Bulldogs to play without it, but there's no other choice for them but to.
Robbie DeMontis is also a senior center, unavailable. Keith Allain told us before tonight's game his team is very shorthanded playing up the middle. So we take a look for the first time tonight at Jeremy Swayman, junior goaltender and a draft pick by the Boston Bruins. Named the Hockey East Defensive Player of the Week beginning on November 18th. He has played all but 7 minutes in net for the Black Bears this season.
There's a reason why he is so good. You looked at that save percentage, number 9th in the nation. What a season he's having for the Black Bears.
I asked Maine head coach Red Gendron before this game, any chance you go with one of your backups tonight? He said, take a look at the stats. You tell me who's going to get the start. Glove down out of the air by Corbin Kaspersky, senior goaltender from China Township in Michigan. He's gotten a lion's share of the work this year. He's 3-5-0 for the Bulldogs.
First shutout of the season this weekend as well against Union, stopping 26 shots. Also, Bulldogs beat RPI the night before as well.
How about that? 62 saves in 2 games against those teams from the Capital District. There's a kick shot and scored by Maine. Big rebound rolled right out to the top of the house. Jacob Schmidt Festrup picks up his 9th goal of the year, now tied for the team lead. It's 1-0 Black Bears.
Quick strike from Maine, and it's right off the faceoff. A quick shot on goal. Kaspersky is able to make the initial save, but it's a low shot, and it's those big leg pads for a loud rebound. Able to be hammered home. And that's a quick start for the Maine Black Bears, and putting the Bulldogs right back on their heels, Kevin.
The sophomore forward from Charlottenland, Denmark, has been quite an addition to this club over the last 2 seasons. It's a tough name to say, but he's a lot of fun to watch. Kleinborg got his stick stuck on the backside of Luke Stevens. Now Stevens digs into the corner for the Bulldogs, trying to chip that one aside. Son of former NHL player Kevin Stevens, who spent 15 years in the league. One of the best skaters on this team. Here's a centering chance in front. Rowan took it as far as he could, and then Stevens couldn't connect at the top of the house. Swayman was sliding side to side, and now Maine will carry it out of its own zone. Olsinski gliding around through the neutral zone. Maine trying to create some options out of its own end. What a start to this game. Black Bears trying to make it back-to-back seasons with a victory over Yale. They got the job done at Cross Insurance Arena in Portland, Maine last year. There's a shot from the impossible angle attempted by Pileco. Now out to the point, Matthews flings one in. That's deflected in front. One of the twins, Evan Smith unavailable, but his brother Mitchell Smith playing at forward. Through the slot it goes, carried out of the circle, secured by A.J. Drobot. Jacob Schmidt-Schvestrup, in his 18th game this year, has given the Black Bears the lead.
Well, the Bulldogs go right back the other way, Kevin, though. A couple of shots on goal and scoring opportunities. Hold possession in the Black Bears in for a few moments. And that's the kind of response you need if you're the Yale Bulldogs. Not going to get bullied around.
We mentioned off the top of the show that the Bulldogs are starting to find ways to win with their defensive structure. That's according to their 14th-year head coach, Keith Allain. Trying to mix some things up, find some units that are working well together, but tonight they've given up a goal just 43 seconds into the game. Billy Sweezy tried one from distance, and all of a sudden, Rob, the Bulldogs are peppering Swayman in goal.
That was kind of similar to what we saw from the Maine goal that's set up on the faceoff.
Keith Allain has 236 wins in his Yale career. The Malcom G. Chase, head coach of hockey and a member of the U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame. He and Ren Gendron, his rival tonight, helped hang that national championship banner above this main end of the ice. Just the second time that the Bulldogs ever reached the Frozen Four as a program. The first opportunity was way back in 1952. Gendron trying to create some of that magic for a Maine program that has two hockey national championships of its own. Two-on-one chance. Here's Kemp. He shoots. Stick wave side, and then the follow shot gets bumped aside. What a great opportunity by Justin Pearson on the go.
Great two-on-one pass across. I think that was Curtis Hall down there as well, showing off the passes.
Yale has the shot advantage, 5-2 here in the early going. But Maine has the 1-0 advantage. Circuitous route for Johnson down into the corner, whips one in front. Swayman just clubs that up into the stands, and we'll get a face-off here in the main end.
Well, Kevin, the Bulldogs found themselves down 1-0 early, but they're coming back with a strong response. As you mentioned, shots on goal now, 5-2 in favor of the Bulldogs. Take a look at that 2-on-1 again. Nice backhand pass from Hall over to Kemp. The defenseman joins the rush. Then a quick shot off the rebound as well. Swayman certainly busy to start this game.
There was a concern for Yale about poor breakout decisions from their own end earlier this year, but the defenseman jumping up into the offense well tonight. Pinched at the point by Lindstrand. Kept it alive into the corner. Sidestep by Sirota. Runs into his own man. That's the goal scorer. Yorsi kept it in the zone. Collected by Donhauser. He gets run up against the boards, and Yale has to move back toward its own end of the ice. There's our player to watch, Jack St. Ivany, wearing number 2. Started the breakout. Now we'll get a line change. Black Bears are 3-7-2 on the road this season. They've been very good back home at Alfond Arena. That stopped by Swayman, 5-0-1 on their home rink. It's an arena that Red Gendron, the head coach, calls the Fenway Park of college hockey. He told us coming into this game, he's a student of history. He loved coaching as an assistant for 2 seasons here at Yale. He said he used to just walk around the campus admiring the building, savoring the history. And Rob, when we pointed that out to Keith Allain, he just rolled his eyes and said, I'm not a dork for history quite as much as Red Gendron, but I love being here at Yale. His words, not mine. Off the end boards, poked along by Patrick Shea, according to his head coach, best shooter on this team. Butala flings one in with the wrister. Skated through the circle by Kevin O'Neill. He had 2 assists during that weekend sweep through the Capital District. RPI and Union, 4-1 victory on Friday for Yale. Foley shot, never got to the target. Skated away by Ryan Smith, product of the Green Bay Gamblers in junior hockey. Yale still controlling the shot advantage. Maine broke through just 43 seconds into the game. Schmidt-Schvestrup got the assist from Adam Daw. Daw has been such an effective weapon on the power play this year. Gets credit for his 6th assist, 5-on-5. Here is Smith, bumped along the boards. Drobot gave him something to think about. Back out to the point, whizzed in. And bounced off the midsection of Teddy Wooding the first year from Rentham, Massachusetts. Drobot, great pass towards center ice. Here's the assistant captain, Quinlivan. Lost track of the puck near the top of the crease and then lost out of the zone by Maine. Not enough reach on that one by Levi Clybor from Saskatchewan in Canada. Prodded along. Here comes Trail Max, the Riga Latvia product, wearing number 34. Now the co-leader in scoring on this team with Schmidt Svestra. Welsh, great dangle, gets into the corner from the goal line extended, looking for opportunities in front. Pearson was waiting, but the shot came from the goal line, and Curtis Hall places it into the middle of Swayman. 14:23 to go here in the first period. Maine leads on the road, 1-0 at Yale. Maine Black Bears open the scoring 43 seconds into the game here at Yale to take a 1-0 lead in this Hockey East ECAC crossover game. Thanks so much for tuning in here on Nesson. I'm Kevin Gale, joined by Rob Siambra, and despite that early flurry from Maine, Yale has controlled the offensive chances so far.
Shots on goal 7-2 in favor of the Bulldogs. Kind of tells the story. They haven't really backed down since that goal.
Last game for the Bulldogs before the exam and holiday break. A lot on the minds of these student athletes. No athletic scholarships here at Yale. All brought on campus for their acumen as students, and of course athletes as well, trying to help Keith Allain build back the promise of this program. Reach the ultimate prize back in 2013. There is so much hockey experience between these two head coaches on the bench tonight. Red Gendron for Maine and Keith Allain for Yale, both with experience at the NHL and college level. Gendron has been champion seemingly at every level that he has coached. Good tap pass at center ice. Plumbed along by Luke Stevens. Duxbury Mass product. Only got as far as the logo near center. Ronnie Emmy played it around. Finished product in his junior campaign. Now off the far boards. Yeah, looking for a deflection in front again. Stevens has been busy in front of Swayman. The reliable goaltender for Maine, 6'2", 200 pounds. He hails from Anchorage, Alaska, and got an opportunity to play his hometown team. Off the start of the campaign, Swayman thought about restarting that play to turn on Emmy, but instead froze the puck for a faceoff.
Since we came back from the media timeout, seems like the Black Bears have tried to clog up the neutral zone just a little more. Stopped a couple of passes in the preceding play. Bulldogs still able to break through in the end, get a shot on goal. The line change now an offensive zone draw.
One thing we've learned about Swayman, he stops a lot of shots, and one of the reasons why, this group for the Black Bears lost five defensemen from last year's team. Two of them signed pro contracts. Three of them graduated, so it's a bit of work in progress throughout the early campaign for Red Gendron. We're getting to a point in the season, Rob, where we're starting to get a better idea of the full body of work for each of these teams, though, as Kasperski stops it for a faceoff. And really, we're getting toward the halfway pole in the college hockey season, and you can see that for Keith Allain's club at Yale, they're starting to feel a little bit more comfortable on special teams, while Maine, yes, they're still trying to piece some things together on defense, but the PK has looked very good so far.
Absolutely. You take a look at the way they've played this year, it seems like you can kind of tell from watching as well. You know, as the practices and games happen, get a little more comfortable, you play your conference opponents, you're sort of able to feel out that pace of play there.
Get the feeling that special teams could very well decide this in just about every hockey game you see, especially early in the season when those special teams are still being built. Off the end boards, Drobot picked up the loose puck. Yale trying to fight out of its own end. Smith goes slashing away at the far side. It's back out towards center ice. Recentered by Quinlivan from Shrewsbury, Massachusetts. Big Boston Bruins fan. We were talking about the Smith twins earlier. Quinlivan has a twin of his own, and his two younger brothers are also twins. There is a twin gene in that Quinlivan family. Nearly an odd man rush breakout there for Yale. Now the Black Bears bursting back the other way. Dangerous is Trail Max in front, redirected, and then cued toward the near side. Second centering chance, and Kasperski made the stop. Got the right leg extended. Here come the Bulldogs. End-to-end action. left ahead for Smith. That got underneath the body. Swayman, watch that puck clank off the referee on that end of the ice. That one's fought off by Kasperski. Just punched it toward the end boards, and now we'll get a stoppage. Our referees tonight, Ken Gates, Brian Goodwin, Jared McMullen, and Ron Morello are patrolling the lines.
Looks like the mask might have come loose on Kasperski. The shot rang off the helmet there. Opportunity before that, yeah. Puck goes off the linesman's skate in the corner, almost directly back out to the front of the net. Wide open net for a quick moment, but great defense by Maine. Keeps Swayman still goal free.
Keith Allain will keep a close eye on his goaltender tonight. He is shorthanded at that position. In fact, there is a club hockey player dressed tonight. Hall on the breakaway, gets stopped by Swayman. He bounced off the shoulder and hopped over the goal line. Hall defers out to the point. Kemp shot batted away. Off the far boards, Maine has to escape. Now the Bulldogs leave the zone. Backed up well by Kemp. Draft pick by the Edmonton Oilers. Former co-captain at the under 18 Worlds for Team USA. He hails from just down the road in Greenwich, Connecticut. 1-0 to score, Maine with the lead as we move toward the halfway mark here in the first period on Nesson. Welsh got bumped near center. Greenway gave him something to think about. One of the tallest players on this team for Maine. J.D. Greenway stands 6'5". Greenway now with a chance going back the other way. Toe poke save. Kasperski got the best of him that time. And I just mentioned some of that size for Maine. They are the 10th tallest team in the NCAA. They average nearly 6'1" per player. Stevens with a backhand feed in front. Look for Rowan topside. Rowan keeps pressing, trying to dispossess Smith behind the cage. That one rolls all the way down. And there's the signal for icing with 10:15 to go in the first.
Well, quick little breakaway by both teams. Curtis Hall at one end, Greenway the other. Both goalies able to stand strong on them. Greenway splitting the Yale defenders on that one. Let's take a look at Hall's. I like the moves he tries to put on here. He also splits defenders. Sort of fakes the back and goes with a quick little forehand shot. May have rolled off the toe of the stick a little bit, but still just enough. And Swayman almost fooled by it.
It was like microwave offense for Hall. Just a couple quick steps near the blue line, and then he was gone. Sophomore forward from Chagrin Falls in Ohio. Missed the Clarkson home game and the BC road game 3 weeks ago with an undisclosed injury. And you could see Yale was shorthanded. They were outscored 10-3 in those two losses. Foley, topside, flips it in. Poked aside by Johnson in front. Puts a little hit into Smith on the opposite side, then rolled back into Swayman, and he says, let's stop it right here. 9:48 to go in the opening period. Schmitz-Festrup's goal still stands up.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
We hope you're enjoying our re-air of the Yale Maine men's ice hockey game from December of 2019. I'm Evan Ellis, and I'm pleased to be joined by the Malcom G. Chase head coach of Yale men's ice hockey, Keith Allain. And coach, my first question is a simple one. How are you?
I'm great, thanks, Evan. You know, it's it'd be nice to be preparing for real games rather than looking over old games. But overall, I can't complain. My family's healthy, looking forward to Christmas season. So we're in a good place.
When we look back at Yale men's hockey over the last 10-15 years, a lot of success, and a lot of that can be traced to you and your staff. And in this main game, it's a matchup between your team and the team of one of your former assistants, Red Gendron.
Yeah, you know, Red and I have a long history. Obviously he was one of our assistants when we won the national championship in 2013. But I met Red Gendron in 1982. We were doing USA Hockey developmental camps in Colorado Springs together. And over the years, I was his assistant on some national teams. He was my assistant. And then we ended up working together at Yale, and nothing better than trying to beat an old friend, I can tell you that. But he's a great guy and a great coach.
When you think about Yale hockey, one of the things that stands out is the home ice advantage of Ingalls Rink. And we get to see it in this game. What is it like playing or coaching inside Ingalls when it's slam full?
Well, the atmosphere is just it's one of the best in college hockey. You know, it's so loud that that I'm screaming on the bench to say things that I just need to be saying. It sounds like I'm screaming. But there's an energy in the building that kind of permeates through our team. And, you know, when our guys leave their time at Yale, one of the things they always talk about is Saturday night at Ingalls when it's full, because it's almost indescribable.
The 2019-2020 season didn't end the way we all wanted it to, with the postseason being canceled because of COVID. What kind of lessons have you and your team learned with all that's happened over the last 9 months?
I mean, you know, the season didn't end the way we wanted to, but the one bright spot, the memory we can look back on, is our final game was a double overtime win that advanced us in a playoff round. So it certainly was a thrilling finish. Lessons that we've learned, I think we're still trying to process that. I would say the biggest lesson that I've learned is that, you know, you try to plan and make a best case set of plans, and you realize that you're off base and the information you have keeps changing. And so you have to learn how to be flexible and kind of roll with the punches. At the same time, you can't stop planning, because when things turn the corner, you want to be ready to go.
Moving to this hockey game, Maine got the first goal, but the Yale team was able to respond. What about the makeup of last season's team allowed them to respond in games like this one? And we already touched briefly on that playoff series against Union.
This Maine game was a big game for us. It was our last game going into Christmas break. And you talked about the resiliency of that team. I mean, we had a really tough start to the hockey season. We started 2-7. And, you know, there are a number of reasons for that. There always are a number of reasons. But the one thing that I admired about that group was that there was never this sense that there was going to be a bad year, or that, you know, we weren't a good hockey team. And coming into this Maine game, we had swept Union and RPI on the road. And so we really were gaining some momentum. And I thought it was important for us to go into the break with a win. As mentally tough as our guys are, it's always good to have a positive experience rather than a negative one that you're trying to lean on. So Maine scored early in that game, and you know, they were a good team. I mean, they're a team that if the season hadn't been cut short, would have been in the national tournament for sure. And we responded well. I just think that resiliency was a key component for that hockey team last year.
Let's talk about some of the players that made big plays in this game. Tyler Welsh had the equalizing goal in the first period. Luke Stevens scored the go-ahead goal in the second, with Curtis Hall getting the final goal in the third period. This team had a lot of really good players that looked like they were putting it together at the right time, right at the start of the playoffs.
Yeah, you know, we had a good mix of that senior class gave us good leadership. And then, you know, the sophomore class was a class that was doing a good job for us scoring-wise. And of course, Corbin really had a strong season in goal after the start of the year. You know, for any hockey team to be successful, you have to get contributions throughout the lineup. It can never just be one or two guys. It can never just be one or two lines. And I think that team embodied that as the season went on. You know, guys understood what their role was. They understood that whether they're on the score sheet or not, they were doing things that were going to help us win hockey games. And it was a really good group. It was a close group. And we were growing as a team, you know, when the season got cut short.
Keith, we thank you for your time and your insight into this game. We're really looking forward to looking back at some of those memorable hockey games from over the past several years.
Thanks, Evan. And I'm looking forward to seeing some of them as well. You know, one of the hardest things, I feel like my internal clock is out of balance, because on weekends I need to be getting sick to my stomach to be getting ready for a hockey weekend, and I'm missing out on that. So maybe some of these games will bring it back for me.
Well, then we'll try really hard to bring that feeling back. That was Yale men's ice hockey coach Keith Allain. We hope you're enjoying it. Yale and Maine from December 2019.
Backhand feed to Billy Sweezy, one of the key seniors on this squad. We mentioned how young the Bulldogs are this season. Bit of a transition campaign, so players like Sweezy from Hanson, Massachusetts become all the more important. Keith Allain has looked to those seniors to help the young players develop, and Sweezy gives some great examples. There's a good double team in the slot. Matthews and Lillibridge came together. Fire the puck back the other way. Hall Great handles again. Flips it in front. Delayed penalty coming. Matthews got off a shot. Swayman makes the save. And there'll be a slashing call against the Black Bears.
Well, he talked quick in the pregame about the Bulldogs being disciplined staying out of the box against Maine. But we'll see Bulldogs get the first power play of the game. And after tying the game up earlier, it's a great opportunity for them to try and take a lead. And great effort all around from Curtis Hall. Yale setting one player deep on the forecheck when they dumped the puck in. His efforts, he still came away with the puck in the end, using his frame, using the boards to his advantage. All around fantastic play.
Adrian Holshinsky will sit for 2 minutes. First power play of the night for the Yale Bulldogs, currently ranked 50th in the NCAA, converting just 13% of the time. But Rob, that percentage is actually up. They ranked dead last in power play 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, it was one game coming in. It was the Bulldogs and Vermont, the only two teams in the nation without a power play goal in the nation at the time. They ended up both scoring on the power play that night.
St. Ivany, great offensive weapon from his blue line spot. Forces it down to Pearson. Let's get past to the far side. Nobody crashing in front. Pearson couldn't settle that puck. St. Ivany eases away. Now he takes the feed. 1:19 to go on the power play. Cross ice pass, back out to St. Ivany, waits, shoots, bouncing puck, deflected in front, Swayman's down, wide open target, Pearson never got the feed, then the switch pass to Kemp, he scores, or did he? No signal, referees wipe it off, light never went on, horn keeps sounding, and now we've got a melee in front of the main net. The fight song is playing, but no goal has been indicated.
My goodness, what chaos on that. It looked like it hit the crossbar, but I didn't hear a ding on that. Of course, getting pretty loud in here. Nevertheless, great puck movement by the Bulldogs. It had a wide open net for a moment right here. We'll see it again. See if we could see it any closer.
I'm not sure that puck ever made it in, Rob.
Doesn't look like it to me.
Now, you see the washout signal there trying to stop play. We don't have sound on this replay. You'll see the puck bounce off the backside here of Swayman. And then watch
defense.
It. Yeah, that was poked in before the arm signal was given, so this could be a really tricky replay.
Of course, the referee is talking to Keith Allain. I wonder if they're even going to consider reviewing this, maybe. It's a tough call on the ice. You know, it's not an easy job the refs have. It's not what I think I'd ever want to have.
And they had a lot of help from those Yale fans sitting behind that goal. They were jumping up and down, celebrating early in that play. They thought the puck had been scored not once, but twice. So Ken Gates having a conversation with Jared McMullen, his linesman, and there will be no review. The review equipment is down the tunnel on the far side behind the Yale bench, so we would have to see the officials leave the ice to get an official video review.
And they pointed a couple times to the faceoff dot to the right of Swayman to signal that they weren't going to take a look.
Brian Goodwin back over at the Yale bench, explaining his decision to Keith Allain, who keeps gesturing down the tunnel as if to say, go review it. So we're frozen here with 5 minutes to go in the first period. Yale and Maine all tied up at one apiece, and now Keith Allain's protests are answered. The officials head down the tunnel to review the play.
Is under video review by Yale challenge.
Yale has officially challenged the play. So let's catch our breath here in New Haven. And we take another look now at what the officials are reviewing inside.
It's a lot of chaos. All four penalty killers plus the goaltender for Maine. Seems like all of them were down on the ice for a moment. Tough to tell.
Well, it certainly looked like the initial shot was knocked down by the post. That was the initial celebration from Yale fans.
The call on the ice is confirmed. No goal.
So the Yale fans unhappy with the confirmed no-goal call. So we go back to work. 107 remaining on this Yale power play. Holshinsky sent away 2 minutes for slashing.
This first unit of the Yale power play has done so well. They got a little break there so they could stay out longer.
Puck escapes out towards center ice. Pearson winds it around through St. Ivany. And now the Bulldogs will recollect. At Union on Saturday, Yale's power play unit went unsuccessful during a 5-minute advantage early in the second period. However, the Bulldogs did a good job of wearing down the Dutchman just enough to set up a goal later by Luke Stevens on a tip-in. So, at the very least, Yale generating more offensive opportunities here, keeping Swayman moving left to right across his goal mouth. There's a reason why he leads the NCAA with nearly 600 saves this year. His defense gives up a lot of shots. Great turn and feed by Lillibridge at the point. O'Neill goes right back his way. Pelecko leaked out, now comes back in. That goes fluttering up into the mesh. And we'll get a stoppage for a faceoff with 33 seconds to go on the power play.
And another note about the Yale power play, they did have two power play goals against RPI, Dante Pelecko and Justin Pearson in the second period. Three of the goals in that game coming in the second period, one of them going to RPI, of course, but of course, we mentioned before, this Yale power play slowly but surely improving.
Bulldogs trying to fight for the faceoff win. Smith got pushed up against the near glass. Nearly tripped up. O'Neill settles it, feeds it in front. Smith got dragged down, and here comes another penalty against Maine. Kaspersky skates off the ice. That's touched high off the glass by Doherty, and now it'll be a brief 5-on-3 for 16 seconds in favor of the Bulldogs. Butala will sit for two.
Big opportunity coming for the Bulldogs. Even if they can't score on the 5-on-3, they still get an extended 5-on-4 now. They can just keep the puck moving around the zone. The way the power play first started out at the very beginning, they won the faceoff and just moved the puck back and forth towards the top of the zone between the defensemen, bent down to the hash marks before trying to funnel it down to the goal. But key moments here for the Bulldogs early on in this game.
Not a lot of real estate in those penalty boxes here at Ingalls Rink. Get a little tight in there for the Black Bears. 5-on-3 for the next 10 seconds. Bulldogs trying to creep in and take their first lead of the game. St. Ivany defers to Kemp. Kemp back to St. Ivany. Who wants it? St. Ivany. Shot batted toward Olshinsky. He's out of the box free. 2-on-1. Shorthanded. Go the Black Bears. The stop. The start. Great poke check. Phil Kemp gave it all up. Hall with a head of steam. Dances around his man. Tries to wrap it in with the backhand. Left it short side. 1:23 to go. 5-on-4 now for the Bulldogs. 1-1 the score. Less than 3.5 to go in the first period. It's been electric so far. St. Ivany. Got a lot of touches on this power play. Helping quarterback up top. That's deflected in the middle. St. Ivany kept it in Bulldogs possession. Pearson shot, big rebound out toward the slot. Bodies go flying. Maine wants a call there. They thought Holshinsky got grabbed. Oh, what a stop by St. Ivany. Great pinch along the near boards. Welsh refeeds back behind the goal. Still 45 seconds to work with. Yale breaking down that Maine defense. What a block by the captain, Fassier. A playmaker, a leader, and a selfless player, according to his head coach. You saw it there.
Got to feel it, so he'll kind of limp off the ice, but not before another great poke check in the neutral zone to kill more time off the penalty.
His skin might match that Maine jersey color tomorrow. Into the gut of Pelecko. 18 seconds to go on the advantage. Maine trying to fight off a 5-on-3. Whipped on the shot. Pelecko left it right at his feet. Forked along by Quinlivan. And that should exhaust the second penalty for Maine. Yale goes to 0-for-2 on the power play tonight. D'Orsi kept it going. One last gasp, nothing there. 2 minutes remaining here in the first. Poisson, first-year forward from Vancouver, British Columbia, on the forecheck. Greenway wandered offside.
Well, the Bulldogs, that second power play, they moved the puck around well again, but it looked like this time around they were kind of looking for that perfect shot, and probably for good measure. I mean, they had get right in the shooting lanes, blocking a couple of shots there, but I think they only ended up getting one shot on goal on that second power play there, Kevin, if any of them even got through to Swayman. Again, credit to the main penalty kill. Not very aggressive most of the time, but that second time around, moved a little more higher up in the zone and got in the lanes.
There's certainly more structure to this power play for Yale. Better opportunities and more depth of scoring talent as well. Keith Allain confirmed that he feels comfortable with two different power play units when a couple weeks back he was just looking to cobble together five players that could go out there and make something happen. A little aimless feed from behind the target by Stevens. Nearly got it onto the tape of Rowan. Flicked in. Swayman had to fight that one off. Back out towards center. Yale on the back pedal. That's Chandler Lindstrand. Former academic All-American and product of the Des Moines Buccaneers in the USHL. 1:10 to go here in the first. Jacob Schmidt-Spestra scored the first goal. Maine had the lead 43 seconds in, but Yale answered. At the 10:32 mark, Tyler Welsh's fifth of the year. Maine wants a delayed penalty, and they will get it. So this could be troublesome for the Bulldogs. Maine will go up 5-on-4 with 52 seconds to go here in the first period. And if the Black Bears don't score, it'll carry over to the second period.
15 power play goals this season for the Maine Black Bears. Five of them from Daw, four from Spestrup. 15 total, that's kind of a big number there compared to what the Bulldogs' stat is, and a few other teams in this country as well.
Daw is a special teams ace. You just mentioned him, the sophomore forward, wearing number 24 for Maine, is the smallest player on the team, but he leads with five power play goals. Curtis Hall, two-minute minor for tripping. Cleared down by the Bulldogs. 35 seconds to go here in the first frame. Yale is 0-for-2 on the power play. First opportunity for Maine. Ranked 20th best in the country, scoring 20% of the time on the man advantage. Frozen in the corner by Pileko. That's exactly what the Bulldogs need. Schmidt-Svestra swings it far side. Big one-timer chance, missed the target from Poisson. That's popped straight up by Pileko. There's a broken stick on the far side. Billy Sweezy doesn't have a weapon. Now throws his body in front. Kasperski got the blocker save. And the first period comes to an end. Impressive shift there by Billy Sweezy. He helped fight off the Black Bears, but their power play will continue for 1:08 when we return for the second period. Yale 1, Maine 1. We'll be back with the intermission report after this.
You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try. Oh, yeah.
Maine Black Bears looking for a seventh win in the last 10 meetings against Yale men's hockey. They're deadlocked after 20 minutes, 1-1 the score here at Ingalls Rink in New Haven. We welcome you back to ECAC Hockey on NESN. I'm Kevin Gale, joined by Rob Ciambra. It was a wild first period, nearly a 2-1 lead for Yale on a bounding puck that just somehow stayed out of the net. There was a review, fans were celebrating, the fight song was played. Everyone was sure that the Bulldogs had their first lead of the game, but it wasn't meant to be in the last 5 minutes of the first period.
And it kind of turned the tides on the way the Yale power play went, because it was so strong, and then it kind of dwindled out after. Give credit to Maine's penalty kill, of course. They just were able to clear the puck out and block a couple of shots. And now we start the second period tied up with Maine on the power play, Kevin.
So some opportunity now for the Black Bears to regain the lead. They scored just 43 seconds into the game, thanks to the Great Dane, the sophomore forward Jacob Schmidt-Svestra. Easy for me to say, his ninth of the year, now tied for the team lead in goals alongside the Latvian Edwards Trailmax. Less than a minute to go on that Maine Black Bears 5-on-4. Swayman backed up, teed it up for his defense bursting out of the back. That's Adam Daw. And a sloppy entry there for the Black Bears. They went offsides. So this will bring the faceoff outside the Yale zone where you see Corbin Kasperski finished top 5 in save percentage last season. He's creeping toward 100 saves in his last 3 games of action, 2 of them victories against RPI and Union on the road. The Yale Bulldogs back here at home at historic Ingalls Rink that has been home to a 2-3 record this season for the Bulldogs. Forked away by Lindstrom. Good poke checking there against Fossier. Finished 5th best in the nation last year with 29 assists. He is such an outstanding facilitator of offense. When he's going well, so go the Black Bears, who lose the zone again. Just 15 seconds left on this power play. Curtis Hall sat the 2-minute minor for tripping in the first period. Fisted in front. Daw may have gotten a piece of it with his stick into the corner. And the power play will expire. So Maine goes 0-1 on the man advantage tonight. Third best power play unit in the ever competitive Hockey East. There's a giveaway. Hall fresh out of the box, and Yale goes offsides. McMullen made the call from the near side. Welsh isn't buying it.
I will say, I thought Mitchell Smith got over the blue line in time there. Maybe it was too close to call again. You know, when you're wearing the stripes, it's a tough job. Curtis Hall, of course, kind of a disagreement after already missing a breakaway opportunity, looking for another opportunity to score there.
You've been very polite tonight. I'm impressed. That's the second time you've patted the officials on the back for having the tough gig. They had a lot to look at on that video goal review, a lost challenge by Yale back in the first period. Welsh hits the brakes and recenters to the near side. Lillibridge on the back pedal. Two-man game here. Nice forechecking there by Smith trying to break up the action. Hall pops free. Give him an inch. He takes a mile toward the end boards. He was bodied away to Ronnie Emmy. Smith dangles, throws it to the middle. The stick breaks into 1,000 pieces for Patrick Shea. His head coach says he has a pro-level shot, and he tried to uncork one there. Here's the big man, Greenway. Gave it up behind his own goal. It rolls into the slot. Nobody was there to pick it up. Hayden Rowan couldn't collect. Lynn Strand fires it toward the near side. Still debris from that stick on this end. Shea, the senior from Marshfield, Mass., had to go back to the bench for a new stick. 17:32 to go here in the second period. These teams played a thriller last year in Portland, Maine. Black Bears won 4-3 in overtime on an Edwards Trailmax goal. The last Yale game before that was way back in 1999, a game the Black Bears won 6-1 over the Bulldogs. Here's a 2-on-1. Drobot throws it into the body of St. Ivany, who gave it up and stopped the rush. Great play by the sophomore defenseman and Yale's player to watch tonight. O'Neill just chips that one toward goal, and Swayman knows exactly what to do with it.
Tell you, the Yale defense, very calm and collected in odd man rushes. I think it was Kemp in the first period, had a similar play with a diving poke check, and then, now of course, our player to watch, Jack St. Ivany. Take a look here, gets the body in the passing and shooting lane, so even if there's a chance in a shot, you really got to elevate it with not really much room.
Keith Lane has talked about his ability to keep plays alive with his great reach. He's so poised with the puck. That time he killed a play to his credit. Back behind the cage, Teddy Wooding, first year, a product of the River School in Weston, Massachusetts. Batted down in front, Mitchell Smith, one of the twins, playing without his brother, team captain Evan Smith tonight. Matthew's shot wiped away towards center. Daw slid right in front of him. And that's an outstanding block. A lot of talent up front for this main group. Some outstanding two-way players. The questions are on that back line. Daw, near side along the boards. This is where Yale forces a lot of mistakes and turnovers. Sweezy played it along through Phil Kemp. Action has calmed down here in the second period. It was end-to-end in the first. Maine scored 43 seconds in. Yale answered 10 minutes later. Hall trying to wiggle out of the corner. Puck just goes bounding into the circle. Back skating here is Kemp. Has to be careful. Sweezy now surveys his space. Gave it over to Fossier. That's tapped in front. Wide of the target. Doherty back up to his feet. Through the captain, Fossier. Puck goes skyward. Pearson found it first. Glove down by Trailmax. Steps around his man. Now to his forehand. Puck is sky high. Kaspersky trying to clear some space with his blocker. Now things settling. Yale has the numbers. 1v3. Not much room to operate for J.D. Greenway despite the big frame. Now he uncorks a big shot. Kaspersky gets the save. His 15th save of the game. All the way down. Greenway's there first.
Kaspersky had to come far out of the crease for that one, too. There was some traffic in front of him, so he needed to get a clear line of vision. Able to make the save.
Smith backhands it toward the target. Picked up out of the corner by D'Orsi. And we get an offside spotted on this end. So we will take a timeout. 14:47 to go here in New Haven. Yale and Maine still tied up at one on Nesson. Keith Allain, head coach for the Yale Bulldogs, looking on from the far side. Now get a closer look at the staff he has built here for the Bulldogs. His former assistant, Rhett Gendron, coaching on the opposite side of the rink tonight. The New England College product from New Hampshire. Here's a centering feed, and scored! Top shelf goal for Luke Stevens. His fourth of the year, and the son of Kevin from the NHL puts Yale in front, 2-1 in the second.
Not too difficult of a play for Stevens on the pass. He got three goals in as many games now. Take a look, another odd man rush. Stevens with that long reach, the tallest player of the Yale squad. He's able to just lift that one on the stick side of Swayman, and Yale takes their first lead of the night.
His second goal in as many games. Got his stick on a rising slap shot from the point. For a 2-0 lead at Union on Saturday. Yale now in the driver's seat, leading 2-1 with an opportunity to win a third game in the last 5 days. There's a centering feed. Kaspersky swinging away at it. Around the cage goes Daw. Back out in front, Kaspersky dodged that bullet. All of a sudden, the energy is ramped back up. Stevens, the draft pick of the Carolina Hurricanes back in 2015. Now with 5 points this season in his senior campaign. Paleka lost that puck off his stick. Lindstrand, gets checked hard by Daw into the main bench. Lindstrand's gonna stay out there. Had to adjust the elbow pad. Great interception at center ice by St. Ivany. He's got a break, leaves it off. The shot comes in from Hall. Never reached the target. Back behind the goal again. Yale on the front foot now. Turned over in the slot. Rolled underneath the skates of Pearson. Backhand chance now crashing in front. Welsh is there. And now some pushing and shoving after the play as the Black Bears try to protect Swayman in net.
Not a lot of room for Welsh. He tries to push it in on net. Pearson there to follow up the rebound. Gets a little poke in there, and then he's got two players to sort of help him move the net out of Swayman's way.
They'll give the assist on Stevens' goal to Hayden Rowan. That's his second helper of the year, and Keith Allain's squad is catching some fire now over the last couple days. Yes, they're still banged up, a couple senior centers unavailable tonight, Robbie DeMontis and Evan Smith, but these are the types of games you have to find a way to win. O'Neill shot just swatted aside by Swayman. He is piling up the saves again, now 17 in the game. Cross ice feed, and a great save by Swayman. Going right to left, and he skates away after making his best save of the night.
Great look for the Bulldogs, and Swayman flashes the leather on this one. Phil Kemp creeping in from the point, and there's Swayman coming out of the crease again with bodies in front of him, going sort of one side to the other, sees it all the way.
Phil Kemp's not going to miss on too many of those. Credit to the junior goaltender from Anchorage, Alaska. 14 times this season he has finished with 30-plus saves. And it's just his 19th appearance of the year. Gives you an idea of how good he's been. Yale trying to double up that lead now. Playing with the advantage. It's 5-on-5 hockey. Looks more like a man advantage. Lindstrand fights that one along. Daw showing some physicality out there the last couple shifts for Maine. It's push in the corner by Butala. Big Philly sports fan who also coaches high school lacrosse. Here's a giveaway at center ice. Daw looking for some help. Just flings it in on Kaspersky. That's easily played. Off the far boards. Backhanded towards center. Nice stop and start there by Kyle Johnson. Kept his feet moving. Trying to fork one in front to Donhauser. Getting a look at the fourth line forwards now for Yale. Showing some depth here. There's a bump in the corner. Johnson lost his footing. There's a glove down there as well. Somebody's playing with a bare hand. Looks like it is Jacob Schmidt Svestrom, the Dane who scored 43 seconds into the game. Off the backside of Johnson. First line back out there for Maine. That includes Trailmax. Third best on the team with 14 points this year, and he's taken a lot of shots. The big man's got the puck. He's onside. Wrist shot comes in, and Billy Sweezy just knocks the Latvian away. 2-1 the score, 11:34 to go here in the second period. It's been relatively even throughout, but again, when Yale has broken out of its own zone quickly and efficiently, they have looked so dangerous, and their scores have come on rushes where foot speed just made so much difference.
Absolutely. They go down the boards, move the puck, center of the ice, and of course, both odd man rushes essentially. That last goal, of course, with Stevens is able to reach for that back-checking defender, get a stick on the puck.
Taraniemi's shot interrupted in the slot. Shea tried to serve it up far side to his assistant captain. Not much there for Ryan Smith. This one rolled back down toward Greenway, and offsides is the call. It's going to draw some ire from the Yale fans. Well, we mentioned J.D. Greenway earlier, the Canton, New York product, who actually played his high school hockey at Pioneer High School in Ann Arbor, Michigan. You may know his brother. How about the name Jordan Greenway, a BU alum, one of the all-time greats for the Terriers, who now plays in the NHL with the Minnesota Wild. Greenway started his collegiate career at Wisconsin, found his way to Maine, and the kid born James, but who goes by JD, is quite a player to watch, carries all that size. He's got some great skill as well. There's a chance in front. Kaspersky had the leg extended all the way, and look at the extra shot there from Adam Daw, just swinging away at the stick of Matt Foley. Frustration starting to mount here on the doorstep for the Black Bears.
Sets it's settling in a little bit, but you know, of course, if you're the Black Bears, you got to remember it's still just a one-goal game. Of course, both goalies are playing well. A lot of time left in this one. Getting close there. Kaspersky, a great save, though, that he wraps the leg around the post and hugs the puck along that outside of the net to cover it.
Corbin Kaspersky won this job, according to his head coach, because of experience. Thought he could handle the workload, especially with a young group building around him. That one whizzes wide. Daw turns and fires again. Back out topside to Greenway, trying to serve one up to the middle. Now here's a breakout for Yale. On the go is Smith, but Bulldogs are back into icing again. 10:47 to go here in the second.
Sorry about that, Kevin. Kaspersky split time with Sam Tucker, departed, had 1 year left of eligibility, so he's playing up at Boston University this year. But Kaspersky seen a lot of action last year, of course, got the experience in and looked good to start the season despite a few losses for the Bulldogs. He did look strong in net. Of course, you and I did see Nicholas McNabb's collegiate debut a few weeks ago.
Problem is, Yale is going to be down a goaltender the rest of the year due to injury. Pileco on the break. Wires it inside and low. Rebound rolled out to Wooding. And Swayman gets another save for his trouble.
Good follow-up from Wooding there on the doorstep, and a nice stretch pass through the neutral zone. Quick shot low for the rebound, and there's Wooding again. Right on the doorstep, but Swayman stands strong as a net, able to hold on to it.
Connor Hopkins is that first-year goaltender for Yale that Keith Allain confirmed before the game tonight that he would be done for the season. Malden, Massachusetts native, was turning some heads, and there was an expectation that he would be the third goaltender on the roster this year. Suffered a season-ending injury before the first game of the campaign. That has led to Eddie Massaro, the junior, wearing number one on the bench tonight from White Plains, New York. He is a club hockey goaltender here at Yale University. What an opportunity. Club hockey team does play at Ingalls Rink. That's not always the case at other universities. But he's familiar with this ice sheet. Certainly not familiar with this level of competition at the collegiate game. Maine is a big, strong, physical team, and you're seeing another example in the corner. Maybe most notably as well for this Yale club hockey team this season, they're playing with a couple women on their team as well, so that's raised some questions in games against other club hockey teams. Are we checking or not? Because, of course, there is no checking allowed in women's hockey. Boisson. Old one in front. That was easy work for Kaspersky. Timeout on the ice. 9:16 to go here in the second. Yale has its first lead, 2-1 over Maine.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Maine out shooting the Yale Bulldogs 24-22. However, the Bulldogs have the advantage on home ice, looking for a third win in a row before the holiday break. It's a 2-1 advantage for Yale over Maine. We welcome you back to ECAC Hockey on Nesson. I'm Kevin Gale, joined by Rob Ciambra. Great to have you on board. Hockey East foe, the Maine Black Bears, matching up against Yale for just the second time in the last 20 years. Surprising that these teams haven't met a little bit more in this hockey-crazed region of the country. Tarani Emi, a little loose with the puck out at the point, and that leads to a Maine offsides.
It's a go off your point. It is a little surprising. We have seen Maine and Quinnipiac exchange games over the last few years. Earlier this season, split the series, the Black Bears did, with then-ranked Quinnipiac, number 8 in the nation, a 4-2 win. And then a 4-3 loss. They also took on St. Lawrence 2 weeks ago, a 5-2 win, and then a 1-1 tie. So Red Gentry and his squad getting a few ECAC games in this season.
You want to look for a tough opening schedule to the season. Look no further than the Maine Black Bears. They were loaded with ranked opponents, and those were mandatory opponents as well. Of course, with 11 teams in Hockey East, there are a lot of league games to play, and season started in a tumultuous way back on October 5th. A 7-0 home loss at Alphonse against Providence, a road loss to Providence down in Rhode Island. 7-0, a surprising result, certainly lopsided, and Nate Lehman again has one of the best teams at his disposal in Hockey East. And a familiar goalie in net from the Ivy League, Michael Lackey, the transfer from Harvard. Of course, Ivy League schools don't allow for a redshirt fifth season, so as you mentioned earlier, with Sam Tucker making the transfer from Yale, Michael Lackey opted for that option as well with the Friars.
The Friars are having quite the season themselves. A couple of leading scorers across the nation for Nate Lehman's squad. I feel like that's a team we're going to see in the tournament again towards the end of this season. And, of course, Yale also has Andrew Goss playing his final year of eligibility out at Colorado College as well. And we talked about the goaltender situation for the Bulldogs. I mean, that's going to be another extra year of eligibility for that newcomer. Will he take his talents to the Hockey East? I guess we'll have to wait 4 years.
It's like some goalie free agency and transfer portal, as they like to talk about now, is pretty busy heading into this 19-20 college hockey campaign. Double-barreled hockey action on Nesson tonight as well. UMass, ranked in the top 15, has a 1-0 lead at Brown in the second period. Look at the long skate for Lindstrand. Nearly kicked it toward goal and then finished it on the forehand, but Swayman got in front again. Boston Bruins have a big, strong goaltender who gets a lot of work here in Hockey East.
Take another look at it. Looks a little tough to sway, but it's not sure where this puck goes. It hops up in the air and bounces a bit. And, of course, with Lindstrand trying to break through the defense, will he have control of it or not? Can't really commit to that first move. Swayman has to be a little deeper in the net, which he is. He's able to make the save on that one.
Swayman set the main single-season record in saves last year, 1,071. He's nearly 60% of the way there, and we have not yet reached the halfway mark for the Black Bears this season. Worked out towards center, Ryan Smith got tumbled down, and here comes the delayed penalty against the Bulldogs. Maine's going back on the power play for the second time tonight with 7:26 to go in the second period.
Yeah, it's going to be St. Ivany. Player had his back to him. We'll see what the official call is. I think it's going to be boarding. So kind of a tough one. Want to be physical on the puck on this play here, but cost the Bulldogs in this situation, as you see the situation. And yeah. They got to make the call there. You don't want to be too dangerous with those hits in college hockey. Obviously a physical game, but all levels of the game, you're trying to eliminate anything that could be potentially cause an injury.
We knew that those dirty areas along the boards would go a long way to determining this new burgeoning rivalry between Maine and Yale. 5-on-4 go the Black Bears. And St. Ivany, one of the best defensemen for Yale, unavailable on this PK. Trailmax waiting patiently, goes down low. Fossier saw his shot blocked straight down by Stevens, who gave Yale the lead on his fourth goal of the year, 5:23 into the second period. Daw enters the zone. Libor slips it in front. Kasperski fought that off up high.
For a moment, Yale really only had three players back as one went off for a change, so sort of one less player in the offensive zone for Maine. They're able to make that pass seamlessly for a scoring opportunity. Kasperski able to make the save off his shoulder there.
Red Gendron, head coach for the Maine Black Bears, said his assistant and associate head coach, Ben Gite, in his seventh season has done a phenomenal job with this power play, better execution, and they're playing with more tempo 5-on-4 as well. 1 minute left in the man advantage after the boarding penalty for St. Ivany. The near boards. Oh, no look pass there. Pretty slick from Doherty. Wrist shot whizzes wide. Pelecko holding topside. There was nearly a hold of the stick. Looked like it got stuck in the gear of Adam Daw. No call. So Maine dodges a bullet there. Would have made it 4-on-4 hockey for the next 30-plus seconds. Instead, it remains 5-on-4. 32 seconds to go on that Black Bears power play. Clubbed along by Sweezy. He is so much fun to watch and has grown within his game over the last four seasons with Yale. Maybe the most irreplaceable player when it comes to tempo, energy, physicality. A little clumsy here for Sirota. Side saddling his way up the ice. Sweezy turns and fires it down again. That'll finish off the power play for the Black Bears, now 0-for-2 tonight. And we get a whistle behind the play for icing. And the Black Bears won't be able to make that change, so tired legs have to stay out there for the draw.
And that's a good penalty kill for the Bulldogs. A couple of blocked shots, sticks in the passing lane. An aggressive penalty kill, especially to start off. We saw Stevens block a shot, clear the puck out immediately.
Teams have combined to go 0-for-4 on the power play tonight. Yale wins the draw. Pushes it down along the end boards. Fighting through is Rowan. Now reverses course. Backhands it toward the near side. Lillibridge holding at the point. Pushing and shoving by Sirota. Keeps the open hand. No grab there. Kevin O'Neill slithers away off the goal line. Stevens couldn't settle that puck. And trying to reach through the big body of Jacob Schmidt Svestrup, who scored 43 seconds into the game. Co-leader on this team with 9 goals this year. Scored the lone goal against UMass on Friday. It's been a tough recent trend for the Black Bears. They were outscored 9-1 against top 15 UMass last weekend, trailing 2-1 here at Yale. There you see Yale head coach Keith Allain to the left, shouting out orders to his team. Former national champion during the 2013 season. His former assistant coach, Red Gendron, who helped him hoist that national championship trophy in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, coaching against him on the other side of the ice tonight. Both coaches talked about the integrity of each other's staffs heading into this game. Red Gendron said about Keith Allain, he really pushed me to be better. History major back in his day at New England College, who is a student of the game of hockey. Spent 2005 to 2011 with UMass. Coached here for 2 seasons as an assistant. And then gained the opportunity in 2013 to be the head coach for the Maine Black Bears, trying to get them back to national championship caliber. He's lifted the national championship trophy and a couple Stanley Cups as well, 1-2 with the New Jersey Devils organization. That puck just kept rolling out in front. Trailmax picked it up in the slot. 4:10 to go here in the second period. Yale with its first lead of the game after that Luke Stevens goal at 5:23 in the second. Great pass through center ice to Daw. Maybe been a little too hot to handle. Daw finishes a check at the end of the ice. Oh, there's a dangerous move by St. Ivan. He skated right through his own crease. Giveaway in front, and that's over the shoulder. Costly mistake nearly. Poisson follows up his original shot. Niebuhr, and here come the Bulldogs back the other way. Smith trying to keep it himself. Slings it far side, and it was underneath the stick of Wooding. 2-on-1 got out of order. He skated a little bit too deep to try and play that off.
I like the look. It's a good pass, just kind of gets a little to the inside of Wooding. Tough to handle, but Smith, yeah, I don't think he had the shot, so I like the decision to pass there.
The Black Bears defense hanging on by a thread here, and we'll get a whistle at center ice. Might be a cross-checking penalty upcoming.
Yeah, looks like it's going to be Mitchell Smith. See a look at that opportunity again. Smith is going off now, and another late power play in the period for Maine, much like we saw at the end of the first. Still 3 minutes left, so it won't carry over unless, of course, another one happens.
So we will check the call. It is indeed Mitchell Smith, as you said. 2-minute minor for cross-checking, and special teams so often the factor in deciding these closely knit contests. Penalty kill has been troublesome for Maine. Has been troublesome for Yale at different segments this year. Still ranking just 60th in the country in penalty kill percentage. Teams were scoring 35% of the time against them entering this night, but they've held the Black Bears 0-2, so that well-tuned power play unit for the Black Bears has gone quiet so far. All the way back down toward Swayman. He's competed in the Boston Bruins development camp the last 3 seasons. And he'll have to play this puck out of the corner after a great diving effort by the Bulldogs on the other end.
That's a great play by Billy Sweezy, a big hit. I think it was on Fossier along the board. He's able to take the puck away, falling to the ice, but still clears it in the process.
Solid forechecking here by Tyler Welsh. Scored the tying goal back in the first period. Had a breakout season last year as a sophomore. Developing into a well-rounded player now as a junior, and it's forked all the way down again. Here comes the four-track pressure again by Welsh, trying to get in the grill of Swayman. Sirota now from the Czech Republic. Team best plus-minus this season. Sirota off the end boards. Poisson, cross-ice feed. Shea went down to an E. Now into the corner, O'Neill pressuring there. Sirota waiting topside. He'll take the feed. Poisson, one-timer, never got past the dot. Blocked shot again for the Bulldogs. O'Neill gets credit this time.
Physical penalty kill by the Yale Bulldogs. Chandler Lindstrand with a heck of a shift. Laid the body a few times, plus a blocked shot.
Well, you can hear the boards popping tonight at Ingalls. That one flutters like a butterfly up into the mesh. And we'll get a faceoff on this end with 4 seconds left on the Mitchell-Smith cross-checking penalty.
Seen a lot of blocked shots between both of the teams tonight as we're almost through two periods, Kevin. It was noticed the goals mainly coming off rushes. I think that's what we're really going to see probably in the third period if there are more goals to be scored. But a lot of traffic in front of the net and in the shooting lanes. A lot of blocked shots, deflections, pucks hitting the glass, really just not making their way to the net like sort of the conventional from around the ice. Like I said, more on the rush, quick pass on a two-on-one, a three-on-two here and there. So
Tarani Emmy, Winlevin, batted down in front by Matthews and out of the zone. Power play is over, 1 minute left here in the second period. Maine head coach Red Gendron said his team had to take what the Bulldogs gave him offensively tonight, especially on the power play, but the Bulldogs didn't give them much on that man advantage. Maybe one last chance here for Yale to double up that lead. 2-1 advantage for the Bulldogs here at home, looking for a third consecutive win in the last 5 days. Puck popped loose behind the goal. A.J. Drobot forces it out towards center. Quinlivan. Watches that one escape down back behind Kaspersky. The Yale goaltender has made 25 saves tonight. Leader on the ice. Trying to improve his record to 4-5-0. Needed a break during the last homestand 3 weeks back from his reserve, Nicholas McNabb, and it's paid dividends for the Bulldogs since. A 2-1 lead for Yale here at Ingalls after 40 minutes. Goals by Welsh and Stevens, the difference so far. Stay with us. We'll be back for the intermission report. After this, you're watching ECAC Hockey on NESN.
You can make it if you try.
Red Gendron, head coach for the Maine Black Bears, said before this game, we have to play harder than Yale. It doesn't get any more complicated than that. So far, his team has shown a lot of fight, but they trail 2-1 at Ingalls Rink following two periods of hockey. We welcome you back to the ECAC on NESN non-conference showdown tonight. Maine from the Hockey East, Yale from the ECAC, getting set to drop the puck for the final 20 minutes. Last year's game went to overtime. What will we see tonight in the final period? Fresh ice sheet. Wasson lost the puck at the blue line. No chance for the Bulldogs right out of the break. Pearson's shot was foiled before it got going, and 19:48 to go in the third. We'll get a faceoff right in front of Swayman, the Boston Bruins draftee who had 67 saves in two games, two losses in fact, against top 15 UMass last weekend. Tonight he has 22 saves for the Black Bears.
Certainly hasn't been an easy night for the Bulldogs, putting some tough shots in on him. Saw a couple of the highlights in the intermission report. Really has had come out of the crease. There's been a lot of traffic in front of him, but seems to be tracking the puck very well. There's a reason why he started the majority of the games for the Maine Black Bears, and of course last season as well played against the Bulldogs.
He's such an athletic goaltender. And his head coach says he's already doing what the pros do to get to the highest level, which Red Gendron understands with his experience from the New Jersey Devils. He said you always have to look for an edge, a way to get better when it comes to your health and athleticism. He's 100% in love with the game, and he has more of a commitment to improve himself as an athlete than just about anyone on this Black Bears roster. Wasson plays it off to Jacob Schmidt-Svestra. He has the lone goal tonight for the Black Bears. It came 43 seconds into the contest on a feed from Poisson and Daw. Black Bears trying to avoid a third loss in a row. They're just 3-7-2 away from home this year. Rowan got caught up in the stick of a Black Bear near the blue line. Comes a change for the Bulldogs. Out of the back goes Schmidt-Svestra. Imagine filling out that name on a standardized test. You have to bubble a lot of letters. And it's a tricky one at that. Tied second best on the team with 4 power play goals this year. Black Bears power play that had been tuned up really well in recent weeks. Lackluster tonight, 0-3. Smith just whistles one in tight. Shea got the deflection. Trying to press it toward goal. Oh, a great no-look feed to Pileco through center. He nearly caught up to it. Had to reach the stick back behind him. Maine was offside, so the Black Bears have to escape. Up through Mitchell Smith, missing his twin brother tonight. Evan Smith, one of 2 senior centers unavailable for the Yale Bulldogs. Keith Allain said his team is banged up down the middle of the ice. They played 4 players short. A couple Tuesdays back against BC. There's a trip. Pearson went down, breaking toward goal. And an easy call. 2 minutes coming up here for the Black Bears. And the Bulldogs will try to double up the lead on the power play.
The Bulldogs had a couple of good looks on the prior power play that they had, but that one here early in the third. Already with a lead, they'll look to expand on it. They'll send Curtis Hall out. He's had a couple of good looks tonight for the Bulldogs. Of course, Pearson as well. And we talked about St. Ivany at the top of the broadcast, Kevin. A couple of good looks as well. Him and Kemp. Usually see them sort of quarterbacking of the blue line, at least, for that first power play unit both this season and last season.
Patrick Shea goes away for 2 minutes. 5-on-4, and let's keep an eye on some of those names you mentioned. St. Ivany working topside. Hall creates a shot for himself from the goal line extended. Pearson now uncorks one. Big rebound, slashed toward goal by Kemp, then redirected in front. Welsh couldn't put it on target. Swayman gets credit for a couple saves again. The steady backbone that the Black Bears need. Giving up a lot of shots again here, although Gale looks patient here. They'll wait for their best shot. Creeping in, Kemp's shot. Slithered aside. Picked up by Welsh, played back out to the point. St. Ivany goes into the circle. Pearson trying to skip a pass, and that's right onto the tape of Sirota, who clears it down.
Not much has changed on the power play for the Bulldogs. Moving the puck around a lot, trying to look for sort of that perfect shot, but they were able to get a couple of rebound opportunities as well.
O'Neill slips it alongside to Lillibridge. And back out, a big shot comes in from Pileco. Flanked it up toward the mesh, and we'll get a stoppage here with 40 seconds to go on the Yale power play.
We saw earlier there's a chance on the Yale power play where Swayman was out of the net, sprawled across the ice. This time around, the Bulldogs wasting no time throwing it at the net. You see this opportunity here. Quick couple of pokes at it, leaving from behind the net. Welsh threw it right back, even just to try to deflect it off of Swayman into his own net.
Yale power play that was clipping at just 13% effectiveness coming into this game. D'Orsi couldn't hold the zone. Now quickly re-enters. O'Neill trying to go with them. It's hoisted all the way down by Jack Quinlivan. Former Massachusetts state champ Quinlivan from Shrewsbury High School. This is a great PK by the Black Bears. Not much to report here for the Yale Bulldogs. 10 seconds away from going to 0-3 on the power play tonight. Swayman had it all the way. Smith was knocking in front, just trying to get his paws into a loose puck, but get another faceoff here.
Quick little rush from O'Neill, tried to just shovel it over towards the net. The tail end of this power play, and as you mentioned, Kevin Smith right there on the doorstep trying to see if a rebound comes loose, but Swayman says no.
Keith Allain looking on, trying to make sure his team is maximizing its potential before a holiday break that will last until December 29th against McGill from Canada. Delayed penalty coming here. Swayman trying to get off the ice for an extra skater, but instead the hooking call will go against Yale first. And now the Black Bears have an opportunity to tie with 15:34 to go in regulation.
Kind of happened on the main breakout, but regardless, it's an offensive zone penalty taken by Hayden Rowan for hooking, and now Maine gets their own opportunity just a few moments after their penalty expires. They're down a goal. They're going to be looking to try to find an equalizer on this power play, which, as you mentioned before, the Bulldogs have kind of silenced pretty well tonight.
They were pretty good on the power play last year, much better this season. Trying to solve this Bulldogs puzzle. Look at the frustration at the dot for Tim Doherty. His coach promised us he's a fiery competitor. He got tossed. Daw took the face off instead. Settled down here, 5-on-4. Back and forth they go. Into the circle, centering feed. Daw lost track of it, bounced off his body. Clybor slips it over to Daw. Now Clybor creeping in. Look for the feed to the far side. Back out to the point. Kept alive by Fossier. Leading point getter on this team. What can Fossier create? The Alpharetta Georgia product. Clybor. Down low to Daw. Poke checked away. Kemp watches it. Exit the zone thanks to Pelecko. Nice team defense that time by the Bulldogs. On that defensive structure that Keith Allain was looking for, Foley stopped the breakout at center ice. Longmeadow, Massachusetts native, who is part of a blue line that's getting better, one of the few seniors that we've seen jump into that unit. Trail Max forces it over to Fossier. He hits the brakes. Sirota takes his place at the point. Now it's on his stick. Czech native goes back over to Fossier. That's a good option. Batted down by Kaspersky in front. He watches that rebound wiggle wide. Bodies go flying in front. Look like Doherty lost an edge. And out go the Black Bears again. Round of applause from the Bulldog faithful. Fourth power play tonight for Maine, and time is ticking away in this non-conference showdown. Yale 2, Maine 1. 13:50 to play, 15 seconds to go on the power play. Smith carried it as far as he could. Sirota tees it up. One timer. Kaspersky got the save. Sweezy guides it out of the zone.
That's a tough one for Kaspersky. Caught it up high, so he couldn't really control where it went. Credit to Sweezy for clearing it out.
Power play is over for Maine. Now 0-for-4 tonight. 5-on-5 hockey. That was Schmidt Svestra, who had the blazing shot that tested Kaspersky. Would have been his second of the night. Scored less than a minute into the game. Maine has failed to score since. Bulldogs trying to finish off a third win in a row. And even their record at home, 3-3 this season. Reniker says, get out of my way, St. Ivany. Got his hands extended. Plucked that puck out of the air. Now the chance developing. Reniker crashing in front. Drobot lost the puck. Here comes a race back the other way. Pelecko forces Swayman out of his crease. Into the neutral zone, 50-50 puck. Team's batting away at it. St. Ivany can't reach it. Outstanding forecheck by Quinlivan. Tossed himself into the boards. Drobot lost the stick. Now Mitchell Smith hoisting toward Pelecko, who has to get off the ice for a change. Doherty looking for options. Found Quinlivan, the assistant captain. D'Orsi trying to add some pressure. Touch path by Doherty. Aimless toward Fossier. 12 minutes to go here in New Haven, Connecticut. Out of his own zone, Doherty nearly left the puck behind, waiting for numbers to join him. Trail Max pressed it toward goal. Backhand by Fossier. Kasperski went down, somehow made the stop. Boisson chases, and there's the icing call. Keith Allain and his staff can't believe it on the far side of the ice.
They got a little close to the goal line there. Thought it might get waved off. I guess not, but Corbin Kasperski has been very busy here in the third period. As you see right here, he has to sprawl and turn himself over on that one. Give the Black Bears credit. They're not going down without a fight, getting a lot of shots on goal here in the third. They've evened it up. It's now 29 each.
Kasperski has maybe one of the more interesting hobbies for these Bulldogs. He's a baker, trying to cook up a win tonight for his team. Off the goal line, centering feed. Pearson nearly snuck it past Swayman. This kid can really move in net. He's covered a lot of space tonight. Making his 18th start of the year, he's played all but 7 minutes for the Black Bears in net. Matt Thiessen is the backup, a draft pick by the Vancouver Canucks last year. Off the side netting, Kasperski saw it all the way. Pinching to that far post, surveying the action from his spot. The Michigander looking on, known for his fantastic attitude, a lot of positivity. Calling forward at the point, Rovaniemi. And there's a penalty at center ice. Quinlivan, oh, excuse me, that was Foley nodding his head, and he took a hard shot and a crosscheck. Look at the respect for Foley coming off the ice. His teammates pounding their sticks against the Dasher, and we've got a Maine penalty coming up when we return. 10:42 to go. Yale's back on the power play, leading 2-1. Major momentum shifting moment. If this penalty holds up, right now officials at the far side talking about a potential 4 minute penalty to Jacob Schmidt Spestra for that clash at center ice.
And it started with a bit of a tangle up that kind of turned into a face mask or a hold sort of around the head area drawn by Foley. There's already a 2 minute penalty coming up. And then a little bit of a scrum afterwards, exchanging pleasantries, if you will. And now the Bulldogs, halfway through this third period, already up by a goal, have a 4 minute power play, Kevin. And this is a key opportunity. I know I've said that a lot, but in a one goal game, you gotta find an insurance marker any way you can.
Big rebound in front as that puck came all the way up toward our booth. I have rarely seen a puck fly that far. So just confirming the penalty, Schmidt-Spestra got the original 2 minutes for a hold, and then they added another 2 minutes for a cross check. We saw that Matt Foley was kind of goading Jacob Schmidt-Spestra into it, nodding his head saying, yeah, you definitely held me at center ice, not doing anything outside of the rules, and then Schmidt-Spestra just completely retaliated, lost his cool, and as you mentioned, Rob, trailing by a goal, that's a major mistake for the Black Bears because now they're playing down 5-on-4 as another puck flies into the stands, and fans have got to keep their heads up here at Ingalls Rink. This intimate venue is giving up a lot of souvenirs on the near side during this Yale power play.
I know the Dartmouth Sports Info Department's a fan of some college hockey ceilings. We saw a puck at the ceiling earlier than one, as you mentioned a few moments ago, came right at us. Sort of hit where the wooden panels meet the sort of underlip of a ceiling under where we're standing. But you're right, sort of for Maine, down 2-1. You can't get frustrated. That's exactly what happened. Turns a 2-minute penalty into a 4-minute penalty. It's been a frustrating night the way Kaspersky has stopped so many great opportunities for the Black Bears, but they're still not out of this by any means, but that certainly doesn't help the cause.
All of a sudden, the clock is the Bulldogs' friend. Getting set for a nice layoff over the next 19 days. Finals first, however. A lot left to do for the Bulldogs before they take that holiday break. Bounding puck off the goal line. That was Hall who got pinched. Another Boston Bruins draftee. Taken by the Bees in 2018. Outstanding All-American prospect back in 2017. Really part of the most consistent offensive line for Yale this year. You had mentioned off the top of the show that there's a lot of youth among those forward units. Curtis Hall playing third line center tonight, along with his fellow sophomore Justin Pearson and the junior Tyler Welsh, who looks like an old man out there. Creeping in, that shot whistles wide underneath the foot of Swayman. Yale trying to do some damage here, maybe put this game out of reach. Wrist shot, fisted high. Pileco put it on target. Forced the save by Swayman. Long skate here now for D'Orsi. Then a tic-tac-toe pass to the near side. Smith couldn't put it on target.
Bulldogs are threading the needle on this power play. Great passing from Will D'Orsi and then going post to post trying to find Smith before.
Gorgeous handles by O'Neill. Smith chopping wood in front. Swayman just crawling across his crease, lost the stick, and Maine clears the zone.
Just about halfway through this 4-minute power play now, Kevin. The Bulldogs have had some good looks. No real opportunity for rebounds. Maine cleared it out, so they're killing some time off it.
Hall tried to force it through. Oh, and the assistant captain lost his footing. Ryan Smith had a shorthanded chance on his stick, but the puck was too far behind him. Still 1:37 to go on the power play for Maine, as shown on the scoreboard here at Ingalls Rink. 2-1 the lead for the Bulldogs. Redirected by Welsh, turned over instead. Through the waiting hand of St. Ivany. Flyers draft pick back in 2018. He's had to stiffen up defensively this season. He has answered that call from his head coach. On came Pileco. Puck evaded him. Another chance for Maine shorthanded. Going down in the wash was Doherty. Here comes D'Orsi up the near boards. Played it back to O'Neill. O'Neill leaves for D'Orsi. Lillibridge flicks it in front. Smith, O'Neill with the back chance. Tried to change up the angle on Swayman, and now we have a delayed penalty coming up. Maine sent it down as far as it could. Yale touches, and the power play will come to an end for the Bulldogs with the player heading to the box.
Yeah, it looks like it'll be a slashing call. Before that, Bulldogs with a good shot on goal. Swayman lost his stick for a moment, but then the penalty happened and Maine was able to clear it.
O'Neill argues his case as he leaves the ice. Timeout here in New Haven, 2-1. Bulldogs still in front.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
7:27 left in regulation. Yale leading Maine by a score of 2-1, and all of a sudden penalties are starting to pile up. There was a 4-minute penalty to Jacob Schmidt Spestrup for Maine, and the power play was just wiped away by a 2-minute slashing penalty to Yale's Kevin O'Neill. So these teams will skate 4-on-4 for the next 45 seconds as the Black Bears try to dig out of this deficit. St. Ivany out of his own end. Watches a nice forecheck there by Boisson. Big J.D. Greenway is out there now for the Maine Black Bears. Schmidt-Spestrup in the box. scored in the first minute of the game. Yale has dominated the quality scoring chances, now leading in shots on goal, 34-29. Last 10 seconds of that Schmitz-Festrup penalty. And now Yale with the break. Pearson, he gets interfered with on his way to goal and will have another main penalty.
Great effort by Pearson. And you know, if you're Maine, that's tough. It's a quick turnover at your own blue line. And I don't want to say you have to take a penalty there, but it's turning into a mini breakaway. Maybe you kind of have to. Nevertheless, a slashing call, so we'll skate 4-on-3 for 3 seconds.
If you tally up the two penalties to Schmitz-Festrup, that is now 4 combined penalties between these two teams in the last 3.5 minutes. Things started to get a little bit more physical in the second period, and tempers maybe boiled over a bit here in the third. Yale has done a good job to draw these penalties, though, with quick feet. Now Schmitz-Festrup out of the box, saved by Kaspersky, falling backwards, lost his stick, and denied the co-leading scorer for the Black Bears.
Kaspersky made a huge save on that breakaway as the Yale defender went down trying to back check. And Yale really had no choice but to ice the puck after the rebound came loose. Take a look at it again. A couple of slick moves. Stuff the inside of that left leg pad by Kaspersky. We've seen a couple of exciting breakaways in this one, Kevin.
How good has Kaspersky been tonight? Took advantage of that little bit of rest during the two-game home series against Clarkson and St. Lawrence 3 weeks ago. And he's closing in on a third straight win between the pipes for the Bulldogs. You'd have to argue this is some of the best hockey that the Bulldogs have played at home this season, and this is another penalty against the Black Bears. Looked like surefire interference on the breakout against the Bulldogs, and here's another look.
It's Pearson again drawing another penalty, trying to go in between the defenders, puts a nice move on, and a bit of a hold there. So now 4-on-3 once again for the Bulldogs. The ice looking a little barren now with 3 less players on it. And a lot of room to work with now if you're the Bulldogs. It'll turn into a 5-on-3 in 48 seconds with O'Neill coming out of the box for a brief period of time. And maybe they'll be able to get those passes across a little with a little more ease, although the last power play that was a 5-on-4, they were still able to do that anyway.
Yeah, that was a first-year mistake by Levi Klybor, freshman defenseman from Saskatchewan. Can't let the official make that call and shorthand your team again. D'Orsi's shot is pulled down. What an outstanding save by Swayman, who flashed the leather.
That's kind of what the Bulldogs do on their power play when they really are given the opportunity to. They try to get shots in from the point, look for a deflection, or at least have the screen in front of the net. As you see, that's Mitchell Smith standing in front of Swayman. Will D'Orsi, he's looked good on the power play for the Bulldogs tonight. Just walks it into the top of the circle. Sharp wrister, but as you mentioned, glove down by Swayman.
Utala tries to serve it around the near boards. D'Orsi goes topside to Lillibridge. Thought about the shot, deferred instead to Pileco, well off target. D'Orsi takes the carom. Lillibridge waiting for it. Now somebody parks in front, that's Smith. D'Orsi flips it back to Lillibridge, creeping in. A lot of ice, as you mentioned, 4-on-3 here for the Bulldogs. And somehow it ended up right in the feet of Greenway, who skates it away. Now Greenway, and a whistle behind the play. Could this be another penalty as Kaspersky went down quickly? Greenway got his stick down in his skates. I'm not sure if it was a true trip on Kaspersky or if that might have been a little gamesmanship. But now Greenway's going to the box. There are 3 Black Bears jammed in that tiny sin bin on the far side of the ice.
Take a look again here as Greenway takes a penalty and not happy with the call. Penalties galore here in the final period. And a little something after the play there.
I'll be honest, Rob, I didn't see much at center ice, and I saw even less in the crease.
Both, respective captains, of course, Billy Sweezy, one of 2 players wearing the A tonight with Evan Smith out, and of course, the captain Fossier for Maine, waiting for the referee's decision as they're talking this one over. A lot of penalties in this one. This is a little more than I'm even used to seeing. It'll be interesting to see what the outcome of all of this is. It's still such a close game, too. We keep forgetting it's 2-1 as you see the reverse angle here. I mean, it seems like kind of a hockey player there by Greenway. I don't think there's much of it, but the referees thought otherwise.
So big J.D. Greenway forced off the ice into the penalty box. Still waiting to see what the penalty will be against him. And I'm not sure you can pluck any more players off the ice. It was already 4-on-3, as it will be for the next 6 seconds. So we'll wait for some bookkeeping here, but the ice is getting very empty here at Ingalls. It'll be 5 penalties against the Black Bears over the last 4.5 minutes. That includes 2 on one play against Schmidt Svestra, who got called for a hold and a hook at center ice. Although I believe one of those should be called a cross check.
Kevin, I believe what you say. I really don't know if you could fit any more players in that visiting penalty box. There's already 3 in there. They look squeezed in there. Now, Greenway's coming out of it. He has some words for the ref. I think his night might be over.
This has the look of a misconduct penalty. He's going over to talk to Red Gendron, his head coach, trying to hear his junior defenseman side of the story.
Greenway's
heading to the
top.
Room. Again, you just don't see much of anything in center ice. And then here's the back end of the play. Just a slight bump of the pads on Kaspersky. I noticed as well that the referees had their back to the play. So you wonder if they turn around and see Kaspersky upended. They have to start wondering what happened there. And if you could read lips on the far side, you could tell that Greenway was supremely frustrated with that call. And it can be hard to blame him in that situation. But more damaging than anything here, Rob, some of these penalties for Maine, certainly well called. Others may be questionable. But when you're trailing 2-1 late in the contest like this, you can't put yourself in that 50-50 area where you leave the decision up to the official. The uphill climb just keeps getting tougher now. And we're waiting for confirmation on that Greenway penalty. So slashing, goaltender interference, and a 10-minute misconduct penalty for shooting the puck out of Ingalls Rink. So right now it's a 5-on-3 power play for Yale. Golden opportunity to put this game out of reach. It'll be 5-on-3 the next 13 seconds. One-timer, St. Ivany slipped. Rubber sticked it as well. That one whistles up into the mesh. And with 4 seconds left on the Stevens penalty, he's up on his feet. There are 3 Black Bears in that tiny penalty box on the far side of the ice. And Keith Allain is just trying to survey all that's happened here over the last 5 minutes or so. This game has gone off the rails with all the penalties. Don't forget Kevin O'Neill served a 2-minute penalty for Yale as well at 12:33. The Black Bears shooting themselves in the foot here. Waiting seconds of the 5-on-3. Fiorsi's shot came in low. O'Neill whiffed on the centering pass. Lillibridge biding his time. Fiorsi shoots wide. It remains 5-on-3. Stevens came out, but the Greenway penalty will stand up for the next 4 minutes. Swayman went down, and a great block in front of the cage. Taraniemi just batted away the third goal. Doherty, from his backside, clears it out of the zone. D'Orsi on the re-entry. Oh, swing and a miss by Taraniemi again. D'Orsi plays it with his feet. He can't get his stick yet. Now picks it up out of the corner. O'Neill keeps his feet moving and missed it wide. Blazing wrist shot. So now there are two Black Bears in the box, serving that double minor for J.D. Greenway. Still 2:57 to go on that penalty. He's serving the misconduct. And now it looks like we may have a holding of the stick penalty coming up here as, boy, the penalties have just mounted and this game has gotten wild over the last couple minutes. And it's gonna go against Yale. DeOrsi stepping into the box.
And as will Tim Doherty. Frustration's really setting in with Maine, and I think Doherty and DeOrsi were kind of going at it. DeOrsi skated away a bit, but then he kind of went back for some more, and they both exchanged a couple of jabs, and I think the referees have just had enough. They're going to send them both off. And with Yale keeping five players out there, I think it's just going to be 2 minutes. It won't go up on the clock, so they're going to sit for two plus a whistle or maybe the end of the game with only 3:40 remaining in this one.
A lot of pen piling up on the scorebook. St. Ivany scores from the point right off the draw. The sophomore defenseman's first goal of the year makes it 3-1 Yale in the third.
I'm not sure if Curtis Hall got a piece of that. He was standing right in front of Swayman and he's leading the team through the celebrations right off the faceoff. There he is. I do think he got a piece of it. He celebrated like it. Nevertheless, there's an insurance marker the Bulldogs have been looking for quite some time now on this one.
We'll wait for official confirmation, but I think you're right. What a great redirect in front by the sophomore forward. A Boston Bruins draftee taken with the 119th pick in the 2018 entry draft. And Curtis Hall just picked up his sixth goal of the year on a gorgeous feed. A wired shot from the point by Jack St. Ivany. He misses out on his first goal of the year, but that is assist number 7. So St. Ivany now leads the Bulldogs in assists this year. Passes Billy Sweezy. And this third period could not have closed out much better for the Yale Bulldogs. All those penalties finally came back to haunt the Black Bears. Kaspersky still has to lock in down the stretch, and you know it will only be a matter of time before Swayman has to get out of his net. Still 58 seconds to go on that J.D. Greenway double minor. And then the 10-minute misconduct, which sent him into the room after he shot the puck into the stands. Sweezy serves it up to the middle. Smith goes chasing behind Maine's net. Back out toward the point. Forked along by Fassier. Kept alive by the Bulldogs. O'Neill presses it along. Sweezy backpedals. Smith in front of the cage. Now comes into the corner, adds some help. Lillibridge thought about the shot. He wanted it. Pelecko instead. On the far side of the ice. Through Smith. Redirection to the near side. Sweezy on the backpedal. Pressing up high go the Black Bears. Now down low. O'Neill with some room in the slot. Swayman had the glove up. And this one goes back out towards center ice. 1:40 to go in the contest. Smith stayed onside. Pushed it along for Curtis Hall. Served up in front. And we count the bodies on the ice now. We're back to 5-on-5 hockey. So it shouldn't be much longer now before Swayman leaves. His net on this end. Sirota's got to carry it into the Bulldog zone first. Adam Daw dispossessed near the red line. Well, Song has to go back. Aimless pass. Tracked down by Trailmax. Now Swayman comes off. Black Bears go 6-on-5. Trying to dig out of this two-goal deficit in the final minute. Puck goes bounding through the circle. Stevens lost his edge. Served up to Trailmax near side, and the puck skipped off his stick. Black Bears looking for angles. Sirota's got a good view. Room in the slot. Took a long time for Fassier to decide what he wanted to do on the backhand. Had some Bulldogs in front of him. 11 players on this end of the ice. And there's a bump in the corner and a delayed penalty coming up here against the Bulldogs. So hang on tight with 23.9 to go. This is going to be 6-on-4 hockey for Maine as Sweezy goes away.
If you're the Bulldogs, that's kind of the last thing you want. I mean, you have a two-goal lead now with 23 seconds left, but you don't want to take a penalty at the tail end of the game like this. And Sweezy, always the physical player for the Bulldogs. It's always known, but nevertheless, not a penalty you want to take, especially with the goalie pulled now. That could turn this into a 6-on-4.
Rob, that's 13 penalties in the third period. And 11 of them, and 11 of them have been called in the last 10 minutes of game action. Well, shoot, there were five penalties between the 16-20 mark and the 16-25 mark. I mean, this game has just been wild in the closing minutes, and we get a timeout now because Red Gendron understands that there's still an opportunity to force overtime against this team for a second straight year.
And it seems like it was so long ago. It was earlier in the period when the shots were even 29-29, and then all of the penalties just ensued. And up until this past few moments of play, when Maine finally got the puck back down to the Yale end, got a couple of opportunities with the goalie pull, they added two shots on goal. Now that you're right, the call timeout, they're down two, but might have enough time. The goalie pulled and turns this into a 6-on-4. And it's certainly going to be interesting to see how this one plays out.
If not for that power play goal tip-in by Curtis Hall at 16:25 here in the third, Yale would be 0-for-8 on the power play. They have had so many opportunities with the man advantage to put this thing away. But here are the Black Bears still hanging around, trailing 3-1 in the last 23.9. Maine wins the draw. That's the start they needed. Served back out in front. The captain chases. Sirota missed the target. Into the corner it goes. Time wasting away. Well pinched there by Kemp. The Oilers draftee is going to take it across the finish line. It works back out toward the point. Smith pushes it along, and that'll do it. Yale's third win in a row. 3-1 over Maine. And don't look now, but heading into the Christmas break, Yale is heating it up in New Haven.
After the start that the Bulldogs had with a win and then quite a few losses, this is great way to end the first half of the season for the Yale Bulldogs. Things are looking up. Finishing off the non-conference win, get an exhibition game at the end of the month, then come back for some more non-conference action on the road, of course. And of course, we talked about that big game coming up at Madison Square Garden against their longtime rival. Certainly an exciting time here in New Haven for Yale hockey.
So Jacob Schmidt-Spestrup opened the scoring 43 seconds in for Maine. The Black Bears never scored again as Tyler Welsh, Luke Stevens, and Curtis Hall on the power play score three unanswered to put Yale ahead for good. So for my broadcast partner, Rob Ciambra, and our entire production crew here at Yale, I'm Kevin Gale saying good night from New Haven. Our final score, the Yale Bulldogs 3, the Maine Black Bears 1. Thanks so much for tuning in to ECAC Hockey here on NESN. Good night, everybody.